Hello, everybody. This is Robert with Deep Thought Cycle. Long time since I've been blogging lately. I mean, since my last blog. Pretty complicated time here. Yesterday we seemed to have a bit of the preview of the monsoon season yet to come. A lot of little floodings. Maybe I should have took a video of it. But I did it. Don't worry, there'll be lots of chances to take videos of rain. As the rainy season is above us, upon us. We got a Lamborghini over there. Two Lamborghinis and a Tesla. NASA actually predicts that we have a much higher, or NASA scientists, I'm sorry, predict that our temperature is rising faster than previously thought. They say a 2-degree rise will cause drastic changes. And we've already risen 1 degree. I guess if you would have seen the weather yesterday, you might actually believe that. Funny thing is they actually say that we may lose all of our important cities and history. I don't know if I got that quotation from Democracy Now or in a newspaper article. But I know we talk about it. I talked about it on the blog a lot. When we talk about archaeology, the last ice age, and about the records that have been lost already, and now we will lose records again, right? As the sea rises. Well, the sea rose a lot after the last ice age. The land bridge from Alaska to Russia. That was actually called a country or piece of land. I forget what they call that. The very whatever that name of that place is. I want to say the Bering Straits, that's not it. Yes, after riding in the great flood yesterday, my bike is in bad need of oil. The heavy rain has washed away all lubrication on my chain. Totally dry. Oh. In fact, I need to clean my chain line. As my chain line approaches 6,000 kilometers, probably this right here will bring me into 6,000 kilometers. Oh, almost lost. Yesterday, that sounds terrible. Terrible, squeaky. A little bit overdressed. I'm sure it's too hot. Yesterday on a bridge, going home in the rainstorm, my chain had some chain stuck on my rear derailleur, and I had to get off my bike in the little rain flood on a bridge with little visibility. To fix it. And I had no choice but to take my pannier off and set it down in the middle of the flood. And because I'm using these Ortleib waterproof bags, they're so much better than the Deuter bags I had before, which were not waterproof. I didn't have to worry. I sat my bag down, fixed my chain, and all my electronic equipment inside my pannier bag was as dry as a desert. In a monsoon, setting it down in the flood water to fix a chain, and nothing got wet. That, my friends, is an awesome reason to have early bags. My camera's straight. I should have had the video on yesterday. I just wasn't in a good mood. I mean, I'm not in a very good mood right now. So I'm trying to force myself to open up a little bit. And yesterday's monsoon Really should have had the camera on, I guess. I once again have appreciation for my tires, my heavy and slow marathon marathon pluses. They did let me down. And I can tell you, in rainwater, in floods, I mean, in the history of me driving bikes, riding bikes, 99% of the flat tires I have was in the rain or during the rain. And no flats yesterday, as these tires are going into 6,000 kilometers without a single flat. I did have some problems with the stem failure of the tubes. I haven't had any puncture flats in 6,000 kilometers. I have horizontal dropouts on my rear, so I pushed my rear tire back a little bit yesterday, the day before. I could tell a more comfortable feeling now. I feel a little bit faster. Maybe get my weight off the rear tire. And I must have moved the rear tire back about half an inch. It makes me wonder if perhaps my rear tire before was not set like perfectly straight or something. Perhaps that's why it felt sore. I tried to set the tensioners to the correct spot as straight as I could set it. Feels much better being back farther. I'll try to keep my tires here and not switch to the Supremes until these tires run out. See if I could do that. Today we're going home through Foshan again. On my favorite ride, except for the squeaky tire, hot shirt thing. Under Foshan, through the little countryside village thing, coming out by Da Foshan Mountain Park. Straight ride, bypassing the hills and the traffic, which is on G105, and getting about an extra 4 kilometers ride. In actuality though, much faster. Check on the panniers there. Lack of traffic over here. See, this is empty right here. Been working real hard on that practice dinner. Coming up on Monday, the dinnerpocalypse. Between my bipolar, manic depressive wife, three autistic kids, and group of Chinese bosses, this dinner is taking all of my skills. Tonight I'll try to buy my wife some clothes to help her look not so manic depressive bipolar. And I practiced the dinners. I'm gonna go with a chili. Actually, chili I didn't practice yet because I can't find 3 kilos of ground beef. Yes, in China, shopping to buy something like 3 kilos of ground beef is hard. And cayenne pepper. I can't find any cayenne pepper. So I'm using Tabasco sauce. But so our appetizer is gonna be chili. I'm gonna soak the beans. Oh, look at this guy's trailer right here real quick. These trailers, the rims on them, huge. I'll look at some of those as we pass them. Okay, anyways, I soaked the beans for 8 hours, red beans. Trying to special order the pork. Oh, my wrap's coming off from the rainstorm. Unbelievable. Have to fix that. See that? Oh my god. I'll fix that.
115.
Okay, but anyways. Red beans, soak them for an hour. 8 hours, I mean. Now I'm trying to get the ground beef special order. Make some pressure cooked chili. Tortilla chips. Chinese people are not gonna like that probably, but I'm not cooking Chinese, I'm sorry. I'm sure that my Chinese cooking, they'd laugh at it or something, so why even try? So I'm gonna make beef chili, pressure cook for appetizer. I'll make fried mushrooms. All the fried mushrooms that I tried to make before with my wife's help on the prep. Well, she cut up the mushrooms I had way too small. So I buried them in the batter, and I didn't have the red wine, or I didn't have beer. I forgot. Yeah, so that beer, and I tried to make the batter the best I could. I wasn't real happy the way the fried mushrooms turned out, but I'm gonna try again on Monday on the dinner apocalypse day. Chicken a la king, made that. Made the sauce a little too thick. I forgot to put the chicken stock in the sauce. I didn't have white wine to put in it, so even without the chicken stock and the white wine, pressure cooked 3 chickens, put half of them in there, or two chickens, put one in there. It was pretty good chicken a la king. We'll make some biscuits on Sunday night before the dinner party. And make some biscuits. And for the Ala King, then we cook this rice cheese casserole. It was pretty awesome. The other chicken from the soul for the pressure cooker. Put it in rice. Made some cheese sauce. Put some garlic and stuff in there. Put it into the oven for 30 minutes. It was awesome. I don't know if the Chinese people are gonna like it though. They don't like cheese. But I thought it was awesome. So that's what's gonna be for dinner. I'll buy a pony keg of some German beer. Maybe some Hollander. And a bottle of red wine. Trying. And I hope the dinner works. You know, it's really a headache to try to do this with my wife, the destroyer of worlds. So that's what I've been working on. Tonight I had to go home and, oh, this great thing I painted my house with latex paint. And I say latex paint, and you might think wherever you live in the part of the world, it's real easy to get latex paint. In China, it's not a real common thing, latex paint. So it cost a pretty penny. And I painted my house and it was so humid. The paint separated. It destroyed the paint. So tomorrow night, I have to try to paint again. Lots of fun. Let me tell you, lots of fun painting houses. I hope I have enough paint. Trying. What else? I'm just admiring the beauty of the day right now. Have this kind of weather with no rain, finally. This is awesome. It's supposed to get cold tomorrow though. And the next day. Hard to believe when you see the weather right now. We'll see if the forecast is accurate or not. But shoe in the street. It's always kind of curious to see shoes in the street. Kind of freaky. probably a story behind all those shooters. But what else we got? Another terrorist attack in Brussels. That's bad. American politics. Everybody's selling out to Israel. That's bad. Sanders seems to be cool so far, if you think it matters. If you think it matters. Tesla's getting ready to make the $35,000 Tesla. Pretty cool. But you know what I mean? Call me crazy. I still think $35,000 is quite a bit for a car. It's ironic how they call it affordable. No, I see a friend from school on Facebook often. When I was a kid, named Sheldon. And it looks like I lost my power. My speaker's out of din. No music. There goes my soundtrack opportunity. Sheldon and I were both going to this suburban school in America. And a very wealthy school. And me and Sheldon were not the most wealthiest kids in this wealthy school that we went to. And you know, I've been gone from the United States for many, many years. And I lost contact with Sheldon. So I found him up on Facebook and stuff. But apparently Sheldon went on to be a coach and coached a lot of sports in school. But Sheldon, like so many other Americans, have a really tough time with finding jobs and employment. Hard working, nice guy though. And, read about his accounts. Even had to go to homeless shelters. Read his accounts of all the other people in the homeless shelters. People struggling to get jobs. You know, all that's missing out of the mainstream media when they're talking about how they're going to give the next generation of weapon systems to Israel, called Goliath Sling and Arrow 3, that will cost billions of dollars while people are homeless in their own countries. They could use that money for opportunity. And kind of seemed like, the whole media, you know, the politicians maybe should spend some time talking to Sheldon and all the people out there just like him, that they really cared. But who, come on, politicians don't care about nothing, right? They're corporate children. Anyways, what else is going on in the news? I went shopping the other day with my child Solaris, and he's just like to get Hot Wheels now, like his brothers. Let's match with cars, and saw a Tesla Model S Hot Wheels car. Awesome. That an electric car has become popular enough against the oil industry's wishes that they have their own Hot Wheels car. In China, even. So my son's got a Tesla Model S Hot Wheels car. Now, you won't see the Saturn EV1 or that EV1, like, who killed the electric car? That, all those electric cars were taken and destroyed. And compactors and all those perfectly working cars, I think GM owned it, they were destroyed. There was no Hot Wheels version made of the EV1, right? So, somewhat of a milestone, even though it's quite luxuriously priced and non-affordable, except to the 1%. Pretty cool that they got that. Me and my son sat on the back of a Chinese motorcycle carrying our bags as one of the, even though I take my bike to commute and to buy groceries, the biggest challenge I think of shopping and buying groceries is locking things up. Being able to lock your bike up safely. And I can't always lock my bike up safely. So in some situations like that, I need to go with public transportation or something. In that case, our public transportation was sitting on the back of a Chinese motorcycle. But we were carrying a Tesla Matchbox car on the way home. Our Hot Wheels car, right? If you could find the irony in that. What else? Beautiful summer weather. So I saw that, I mean, as a Tesla 3 release day comes, and you see SpaceX getting ready to start its heavy Dragon Heavy, is that what it's called? It's kind of exciting. No. Can't know if we got any other scientific news stories that I could remember off the top of my head. I've just been so busy lately. Any news stories? Can't really think of any. Amazon merging with Office Max or something. You see all these Office Max and Office Depot or whatever. These are just distributors. As production becomes more streamlined and localized, and producers distribute directly, we're gonna see a huge change in the way retail stores work and the whole idea of what retail stores are. You see, on the AI front, you saw somebody that created a pretty face, a pretty realistic looking robot. Forget his name. He had some news coverage lately. And he made a joke to the robot. He says, "Please don't tell me you're going to destroy human beings." So the robot said, "Okay, I will destroy humans." It's pretty funny. Because the programmer says, "Please don't tell me." So the robot says, "Okay, I will destroy them." But the robot asked if they like people, what they do with it. And I think one of the answers was, all the people it's like, it likes, it would put into its people zoo. So, there you go, that's a good robot can get a job working for, who was that? Some kind of was it Hardee's or somewhere? Some big fast food restaurant chain said that if minimum wage was raised to $15 an hour, then that would make automation of those jobs more affordable. And all those jobs that are $15 an hour will be automated. Out of existence. That's a pretty direct threat from, I forget, it wasn't Hardee's, it was some kind of huge fast food conglomerate owner. So this just goes to show you, we're gonna have a little change coming up. And the jobs available to humans as AI gets better. Google sold its Boston Dynamics. I can see the high-speed train over there. I don't know if you can see that clearly. The horizon. This is one of China's high-speed trains. Google sold its robotic hardware venture with Boston Dynamics because, they also sold, I didn't see the news, but they sold their Motorola outfit pretty quick too. It seems to me like they realized that the software is the challenge now more than the hardware. I mean, I think that's what it comes down to, is it's all about software programming stuff. So as Elon Musk has predicted about AI being the next huge thing, man. You know that song? You don't have to live like a refugee. Actually, you do have to live like a refugee. There will be refugees from unemployment. I think we should be calling homeless people refugees. Jobless people, refugees. I mean, jobless, homeless, countryless, all refugees, right? I guess some to a greater extent. The others. I feel sorry for my Chinese students, man. What a depressing day. Go teach them. They are so much not getting taught anything. Their education is so poor. You talk to the Chinese 8th grade students, like, about, I don't know, you want to talk to them about blue whales or animals that are going extinct. Chinese students in middle school, high school, don't even care. Talk about geography, they don't even care. They don't have any idea about geography. They don't have any idea about world events. They don't want to talk about blue whales. They don't care about blue whales. They have a section in their English book that I have to teach today about endangered animals. And the lack of apathy from the Chinese students and all the years that I've taught this topic is completely appalling. And they have to actually, in the book's actually changing. Well, changing this year. In the book, they actually have to do something like create like a mind map, right? Like a outline. And talk about the animal, choose one of the 4 endangered animals in the book. Talk about its habitat. Characteristics. Doesn't make an outline. Chinese students do not give a fuck about that. You ask them, where do you look for information? Is it an encyclopedia? Oh, I have to use my GPS here. So I don't get lost here. Yes, that's the right way. I gotta go right. I asked the students. I say, how are you gonna do it? Where do you look for information about blue whales? Use your encyclopedia? There's no encyclopedias in the classroom. There's no books for research inside the Chinese classroom. Nobody's ever seen an encyclopedia. Use the internet? There's no internet in the classrooms. Internet is never used to teach the kids. Go home and use the internet. Well, luckily I bring a mobile hotspot to the internet, to the classroom to teach kids. So I said, okay. So I got the internet, where are you gonna go? Well, if number one, even their Chinese search engine Baidu, most of them would not even look on the internet for anything. We're talking eighth grade students here. And this is typical from all the students I've ever taught in 15 years. Not just from this school, not just from this group, not an isolated case. But even if they do use Baidu, which China is the only country in the world forced to use Baidu because they're not allowed to use any other search engines. I say Wikipedia, not one student in that classroom uses or even thinks about using Wikipedia. They don't even think about using the internet. In fact, the only thing they would do is if some student did it, they would all copy. They'd all copy one student in the classroom. And that's how it is from elementary school to high school in Chinese education. Teachers don't care to make kids think. Kids are not taught to care. There's taught no research skills, no innovative skills. So much information is hidden from them and censored from them. It's either censored actively through like blocking websites or passively through lack of opportunity. And you know what? I mean, if you're creating a workforce for cheap labor to work in a factory, like empty brain population of zombies, easy to control, then it's like the perfect education system, man. But somebody said education makes people impossible to enslave. I mean, it is depressing for me as a teacher to teach in that environment and to see those kids in that future of humanity being placed into that position. I'm not having any challenge at all, not having any hope. It is the opposite of what education should be. And if you're thinking to come here to teach in China, that's something they don't tell you. And that's something that a lot of people are not going to realize unless they spend some heavy-duty time in China. And when you get those kids in university, because I have taught university, I mean, it's like having a child that's never gone to school, never done a book report, never done any kind of research homework. And when you finally get that report out of them at the university level, it's much worse than like a 10-year-old child's report. So you see these kids that I'm passing on my bike here, students just like this. Why, they go to school all day and they're not bad children. Their brains are empty. Their opportunities are dismal. And that's the sad thing about living in China. There's a lot of parents you talk to. A lot of their parents, they have no idea about blue whales. And I only use blue whales as an example. I know that this guy on YouTube wants to call me some kind of sell. What'd he say? Self-empowered. Or whatever he's talked about. I forget what he said. Self-deserving, whatever his label was. Self-empowered hippie or whatever. I don't know what he called it. I'm not a self-empowered hippie. I use a blue whale as an example. Any topic. Chinese people have absolutely no idea about. In this day and age, 2016, and the future is facing our humanity. And you have, and every, I mean, all too often you see the results of this in society. You see fake baby milk, fake vaccinations being given to babies, like fake everything. I mean, all the products, the quality control is like terrible, dangerous. And a lot of people are, I just want to say something bad. I'm sure I'm going the right way. I'm not bashing China. But I mean, it's like a stew pot, you know? You put all these factors together, you get dirty, polluted rivers. You get villages of people dying from cancer. You get history being destroyed. You get innovation being stifled. You get race to the bottom situations on a global level. That's not a good thing, my friends, if you have any. And even to see this through my eyes, if you've been somewhat educated and you bear witness to a different way of life, it's difficult. And it's difficult to be a teacher and to see that system of that system being propagated, being part of that system is a hard thing. So I found it rather depressing. You know, and I try to use videos like today. We're teaching about in-depth teaching about nouns and pronouns. So I got this video of these students, middle school students, I guess. There's a little temple there. You see that temple? Yes, you could know about that temple. Don't know anything else. Some kind of Chinese temple, who knows? Burning trash down there. See, this is where they burn trash. Anyways, I showed them this video of these kids from, I don't know, maybe Vietnam, maybe a school in Singapore. I'm not sure where it was. Because they didn't say their nationality, an Asian school. And this is a video I found on YouTube of these cool kids, these girls that made a presentation about the different kinds of pronouns, right? And I thought it's good for the kids, you know, to see other children their age put together their own presentation, put together their own video. These children in China, all 50 of them, 55 per class, have never put together a presentation or a video about anything. I mean, really, not one presentation. It's a sad thing. And, you know, they got the cell phones. They got the technology. They can do it. It's not like technically unfeasible. They all have the internet. But these presentations are not being made. So I show them their own kids, their own age, to do that. Good, how are you doing? And these kids don't, you know, they laugh. They really don't give a fuck about, there's some kids in the classroom that pay attention. But they're, after being taught their whole life to never do something like that creative, they're actually turned off by any situation that they're put into. And they don't care. And so this is China. We don't do that here. We close our eyes to any of that. And it's not their fault. They're just the students of no opportunity. So that's a sad thing. Sad thing. I try to encourage and show them. I mean, as a foreign teacher, though, I'm an outsider. Very little respect is given to me from the public schools. They will never accept me as being a real teacher. It's just about face for the families mostly. True education to teach them grammar and to teach them quality things that would never be allowed. They're welcome. I mean, that's like welcoming inspectors. Or something, or standards that would never be agreed to. It's too progressive. So, no choice. No choice but to be part of the system. But I try. I give these students every kind of opportunity that I can in the 40 minutes a week that I teach them. And to tell you the truth, I mean, my private classes that I teach, but my own training that I teach for years, I teach completely different than the public schools. In the public schools, I have to use the public school textbook. I have to have groups of 50. Groups of 50 per class. I have to do it the public school way. But in my private classes, I teach them just like I teach my kids. And you could see them making great progress. And so I should emphasize that the children are awesome. And it's the opportunity that they're given which is problematic. And you see people in China with great wealth. Like the guy just had the BMW. And you see people become quite wealthy and quite successful. And some of the most successful people you'll meet in China, they won't know about blue whales. They will not have done presentations. The way that they make their wealth is entirely different than what you may imagine. Now, I'm not saying that the 1% from America or other countries have made their wealth in a good way. And I'm also not saying that everybody who makes money has done it in a bad way. And I'm also not saying that there are not any smart Chinese people that do research, that can't do research and can't get presentations. I'm talking about on a large scale model. Yes, I know some smart people. I've had some students who have done a good job. But I emphasize when I say some, a very minuscule amount. That's a huge difference. And that affects everything in society. Like, if you go to a foreign-owned retail chain or like Metro or somewhere, and even with the system in place of the chain stores, I mean, even if you go into McDonald's or KFC, something which they've automated their worker efficiency to such a great extent in order to franchise, you will see the Chinese people making mistakes. All the restaurants will run out of food, and they give you the wrong orders all the time. Or something's wrong. Or, I mean, just a million different mistakes in quality. And this all boils down to what happens in the classroom. And using the example of McDonald's and KFC, trust me, there's examples in hospitals, healthcare, engineering, in every sector. The results are quite clear. So that's my little spiel about, so I mean, you have to remember that China has 1.36 billion people. 18% of the world's population. So a small percent of people that might be smart, it's not representative of the whole. And whenever you see that smart Asian student from China in your home country, like Canada or the US or wherever, you have to realize that they are so elite in their own country. Just to be able to get out of China and go to school in the US, that is not representative of all the others that are left behind in China. So a lot of people, I think, mischaracterize Chinese students as being so smart and they're so hardworking. You know, the student itself in any country could be equally hardworking given equal opportunities. But the system that the student is from in China is definitely not creating that image where you see when you see the government or the big executive's child that's grown up with private lessons their whole life and extremely wealthy, getting the opportunity to go to the United States or another country to immigrate. That is not, their level of education is not what's typical in the school system here. Okay, that's something that should be realized. This guy on his scooter right here, this guy on his motorcycle, their kids are not going to America. Those people walking right there, kids are not going to America. You see a lot of Lamborghinis here. Ferraris, BMWs, Mercedes. There's a lot of people that don't have those up. So anyways, that's my little talk about that. Is a homeschooling father with my bipolar manic depressive wife at home teaching my children while I'm at work. It breaks my heart to be away from my kids. And my wife does a good job when she's not depressed or cycling bipolar. I constantly try to help her and to be a better father and to go home and to love my kids even more and try harder to give them even a better lesson after what I see in the classrooms all day long. It's terrifying to see that in the classrooms. Absolutely terrifying. So it's like a special hell to be going to teach these kids and not be in my home with my own kids. And as poor as I am, you couldn't pay me to put my children in a Chinese school. There might be some exceptional some international schools that cost as much as Ivy League universities in America cost. But other than that, there's no way. So I believe homeschooling is the best way. And most expats in China homeschool their children. Many, 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 many more expats would not even think about, and they actually have a lot of hatred towards China and try to leave China as fast as they can when they have kids because they think it's a terrible place for children. I am not in one of those groups. I don't think China's a terrible place for children. I think homeschooling is good. I'm in the unique situation that my wife is sick and has mental illness. And I have three special needs kids. If I had a wife that wasn't sick, my life would be much better, right? Sure, we could enjoy homeschooling more. I do want to stress that I never would want to leave China because of the school system. Even if I lived in the U.S., I would most likely be continuing to homeschool my kids. With the exception of some special needs speech therapy that I can't get in China. But if I was in the U.S., I wouldn't be able to afford that anyways. That's not a service I could get. They don't offer the healthcare. The healthcare in the U.S. is too expensive. The healthcare in China is non-existent. Let me tell you a secret. When something is too expensive, it's not a lot different than saying non-existent. So not having that option in China is no different than not having in the U.S. In China, they don't even have that kind of technology. Psychological healthcare and speech therapy and all that good stuff. It's non-existent in China. In America, it's non-existent to the poor people, which those poor people make up a majority. So, or an ever-growing minority. What is a poverty level in the US? I don't know. That vaccination issue, though, that just happened. You know, what a terrible thing to make fake vaccines and then try to make money from giving those fake vaccines to babies. I mean, people can be hard as fuck and very callous. That is the reason why some people don't want to be in China. It's understandable. But I vaccinated 2 or 3 of my kids. I didn't vaccinate my last child. A lot of people say, oh, against vaccinations, about the autistic time. You know what? I've got like 3 autistic kids, man. I mean, My last child had a very large infection on his arm after the vaccination. But considering that one of my friend's fathers is in the hospital for tuberculosis, and I've learned that tuberculosis is a very active thing in China, I am now considering what I have to do to get my 3-year-old unvaccinated child vaccinated. I mean, the stories that I hear in China about my friend's father and tuberculosis treatment and also having lung cancer too, or liver cancer, I mean. It's terrible. The hospitals pretty much keep him prisoner and extort as much money as they can from his family that's paying for his medical treatments. And that's what hospitals do in China. They're really good at that. But because he's got tuberculosis, none of the other hospitals will even see him. They're afraid he'll contaminate the hospital. And he's a Chinese citizen, not so wealthy, so he's unable to take his child, or to take his father to Hong Kong for care. So his father's stuck in the north, in the same village where people have been dropping off from like flies from cancer, young teenagers, and people stop having babies. The birth rate has dropped almost nothing in the village. So that causes me to consider vaccination. But right after like my friend's story about and seeing him go through hell. I mean, his mother died of cancer, his father's dying of cancer, everybody in the village dying of cancer, and he's got tuberculosis in the hospital, and the way he's not allowed to get health care outside of where his father's house registration is, and how his father's quarantine, and just a nightmare. I started to rethink my position on vaccinations for the safety of my child, one of my children. And right when I was getting ready to go get vaccinations, then this story comes out in mainstream media here about the 300 children that were given fake vaccinations. And let me tell you something. I mean, if there's a story that 300 people were given fake vaccinations, I'll bet you the number of people receiving fake vaccinations in China is much, much higher than that 300 that was reported. And I don't want to pull random statistics out, but I've even heard it mentioned that like something upwards of 60 or 70% of medicine in China is counterfeit. I can't comment on the validity of that. It would not surprise me if that rate is accurate. But I can tell you, when I go buy something like USB cables, or when I buy computer goods, or when I buy, you know, food, flour, when I buy that stuff, I gotta worry about that being fake. Hey, meow. I worry about that stuff being fake, so it doesn't surprise me at all. And sadly, about the medicine. It's a sad thing. And you know, I get drinking water. I don't have really enough money to buy a filtration system, so I ordered bottled drinking water. But I'm actually worried. You know, I often think my drinking water is contaminated if they really filter it. I cut my own Chinese wife using water to cook our food. And with my three autistic children, I often question how much she used sink water during her pregnancy when I didn't catch her, and if that's why my children have autism. So, China's dangerous like that. A lot of Chinese people will say, oh, look, there's a lot of Chinese people. It's no problem, and it doesn't kill the Chinese people, but the truth is, no, it does hurt a lot of people in China. And there's no coverage of it. There's no network news. There's no hospital sharing information. There's no statistics being reported. So people become oblivious to the dangers of unfiltered water and it contaminates and stuff. So that's some of the problems that are faced by living in China. In case you didn't know that. Something to think about if you're having kids here. Now, I'm in the south where the air quality index is commonly between 200 and 300, which is not good. But if I was in the north, I would definitely not have my kids here. That's too dangerous. In that situation, that would be too much for me. Yeah. After doing this blog, I'll go home and I'll have that conversation with my wife. I'll say, "Hi, honey, when our first two kids were born, how much sink water were you boiling?" And you know, I've educated her. I've told her not to use sink water, but as your whole society accepts that, I mean, when I say something like that, I sound like the eccentric foreigner. Where, you know, how does 1.3 billion people that cook their water and use it have any kind of, how do I have leverage against that? It's a pain of a multicultural marriage when one of your spouses is completely ignorant to the safeties of so many things and the dangers of third world living. Well, that's kind of a depressive vlog, but I did it. Finally, the electric bill. Well, this is Robert. I'll see you guys next time. Come ride with me. And maybe it'll be a little bit more cheery next time. Bye-bye.